Hello. As I said, we'll begin in a few minutes. Just to have a regular sound check, I would like to know that you can all hear me. There is no problem or interruption.
Yes, we hear.
Okay, thank you. I presume the time is a bit difficult for some of you that are probably having parallel obligations at 5. We'll give it 2 more minutes and then we will begin. As I said, for those who came just in, we'll begin in 2 more minutes, in 5:05. There's a steady progress of people joining in. We'll begin in a minute. Okay. If you can, for those who can actually turn their cameras on, please, you can do that so I can take a picture at the beginning of the course. I'll take one at the end of the session. If you cannot, okay, it's all right. It's not a big deal, but if you can, please turn the camera on so I can take the picture according to the regulation we have for the program. Thank you. So here, and let's begin. My name is Argyris Pirides, and I am the managing partner. I'm a managing partner of Anthology Management, and also the CEO of Anthology Ventures. I'll be your host this evening, and we'll continue with the second part of the first module of the acceleration course. We're now in the early acceleration section of the whole course as we describe the ecosystem formation and parameters, as well as how to set up and run an acceleration program. We will deal today mostly how to run an acceleration program or how to participate in an acceleration program. And we'll try to connect it in the very beginning of this session with assessing the ecosystem. So let me begin, but before I start a big monologue that's sometimes very, very boring in these webinars, I would like to hear a little bit of you. Have you ever do you have any experience from running an acceleration program or participating in one or assisting in one of those acceleration programs ever? If any one of you has such an experience, please feel free to share a few words about it. Okay, so that means that there is no relative background, or we are all too shy to share, which is okay.
No, unfortunately not. Okay. Not yet.
All right, it's not okay. Yet. It's okay. So the interesting thing about the acceleration program that also Adrian described yesterday is that it is a Darwinian process. So in a Darwinian process, what happens? We have the survival of the fittest. Right. So in this evolutionary sequence, more projects, more teams join in the beginning, and fewer actually survive. As Adrian explained yesterday, the reason for this is because we want to help all startup projects either fail fast or progress fast enough. Why we want to do that? Well, basically, because if there is something wrong with the overall concept and the team and everything around it, we want that project, that startup venture, to either pivot, that means change the concept, change the parameters to the extent it can, as to minimize exposure to expenses and all different kinds of risks, or correct, steer the project to a more viable direction. If, of course, everything is well, which is not, it's never the case, there is always a problem there, we need to correct it to help the startup founders move on fast enough as to get a competitive edge and, of course, be able to claim whatever they can from the market, from investors, or whatever help they can get on their way. Now, I will start by sharing my presentation here. So bear with me. And here it is. So we'll start with this slide that Adrian, I think, shared a few days ago. Let me just confirm that you see the slide as I'm sharing now.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, thank you. So in the beginning, we discussed that, you know, Adrian said that there are three types of acceleration programs based at least to the Nesta categorization, the investor-led accelerators. And these are programs that are supported by investors, angel investors, VC funds, or other stakeholders actually assign money. They put money in order for the program to run, but also to support with monetary terms the participating startups. So they actually put money in the startups, not just the program. We have the matchmakers, the different kind of acceleration programs that match the needs of a host company, you know, and the organization, and the startups. That is happening in order to facilitate the needs of the host organization and also match the needs of the organization with the startups. For example, if we have a telecom company and the telecom company is looking for a new product and innovative ideas and ways to support and serve its clientele, then the host telecom company will invite startup projects that can also address same needs. This is a matchmaking. And the ecosystem accelerators who are actually developing what? The ecosystem. So they try to raise not just the entrepreneurial spirit, but also engage and support entrepreneurial powers and grow the system bottom up, okay? Although there is top-down help, but they want to really grow the system in a bottom-up way. Now, let's go slide that we want to start with today. And here we are. So in order to begin the design of a program, we need to explore and find the right recipe. Now, the acceleration program, it might sound the same for whoever, you know, wants to, you know, have, you know, explores the startup system, but not all acceleration programs are created equal and run equal. So there are two viewing angles here, the one of the startup, and the startup will need to decrypt the program's secret, how the program runs, who's running it, who are the alumni of the program, if there is funding, how the program will help you, where is it, and what kind of resources it has available for you in order to find if it is the right match for the startup. Now, many startups, actually most of the startups, to be honest, they don't do the right due diligence in their examination in order to understand if that project, if that acceleration program is the right for them. And especially when there are a lot of program options and the ecosystem is immature, then the selection process on behalf of the startups is not so thorough. As a result of this, we see many startups applying for programs that are not the right fit for them. So a good practice for any startup before joining a program is to have, besides, you know, of course, exploring the website and any material is ready there, interview other alumni companies that graduated the acceleration program. It's possibly, you know, the same thing that could happen if you apply at a university that out of your town or out of your country that you don't know what's happening, and you ask other graduates what was their experience with professors, classes, the campus, life over there. It's the same thing. If we reverse the viewing angle and we examine the acceleration program from the prism of the accelerator itself, the organizers. So in that case, one of the most vital things that an accelerator program organizer has to do is to understand where they should set the bar for the program. How high? What expectations an acceleration organizer should have in order to run successfully the program? And why we want to do that? Well, we want to do that because not all ecosystems are equally strong, equally ready, and equally populous in order to do what? Attract the talent that you want to run the program efficiently. So this is one thing. The other thing has to do with the promises we make. Many acceleration programs have very impressive websites and make many more claims about the kind of people, the kind of support they give, and you know, and probably the monetary or non-monetary values that they supply to startups. But are these promises always kept? Well, many times they're not. I'm not saying that all the times or most of the times, but many times certain elements of acceleration programs are not as strong as they are advertised. So in order to orient and fine-tune the acceleration formula to adapting the program, we have to do a lot of homework in order to make sure that we supply the right program for the ecosystem that we address. So how do we do that? Well, like in every organization and planning of a service into a market, because this is the thing, we are planning to offer a service in a market, like a company, right? What we should do is also understand how the market works, how big the market is, right? If there are competitors in any way, no matter if we all want to help, they are also, even all the help is competing with each other, all the helpers. And many times the helpers are common or have very common denominators there. So one of the very first things that we have to check is the maturity of the local ecosystem. So what do we mean with the word maturity of an ecosystem? Well, the maturity has to do with A, how old the ecosystem is in the particular sector, let's say the startups. 1, 2, 5, 10, 15 years old. What had happened in that ecosystem? How many successful companies? And how do we find success? What about the additional facilitators that help startups in that ecosystem? How many they are? And what kind of help they offer? Funding is also a very common characteristic of the maturity of an ecosystem. And typically, the more funding sources are available, typically, I'm not saying always, usually the more advanced the ecosystem is. But sometimes there is a plethora of funding sources, but the ecosystem does not necessarily follow in the same speed as the funding sources expand to serve the ecosystem. The geographic reach of the program is also very, very critical. And why we say that? Because many programs in this global, you know, ecosystem of startups are connected and they can attract talent from many other countries. So for an example, you know, in Greece or Bulgaria that we as an quality management operate, we can attract talent from the bigger region. But not all startup facilitators like an accelerator can equally serve or support startups no matter where they're coming from. So there can be certain restrictions depending on if the company should be established and where that company should be established. And sometimes that is connected with the type of funding or other regulations that any startup program goes by. The focus or degree of sector specialization is another very important thing. So we have programs that are sector agnostic, so they can take any kind of startup from fintech, medical sector, life sciences, retail, you name it. And other programs that focus only in specific sectors. Now, this can also play a very important role, because certain startups, and especially the most advanced they are, they look for a more specific type of help. In the beginning, a sector agnostic program that can address, you know, can address and offer help to all kinds of sector, because the basic knowledge, the basic expertise, the basic help that is necessary is the same for most of the startups. As you go and go up the ladder of evolution, the type of help you might need has to be a little more specific. This is where we need vertical accelerators, vertical programs that offer higher degree of specialization that can support the later stages of a startup. And again, funding, as I said in the beginning, the types of funding that is offered can also play a very important role. And there are different kinds of funding. We have, you know, public, we can have regional programs, like we have in the EU, or, you know, many other countries or regions have their own regional programs. We have angel investors, we have sponsors, and of course we have other institutions that provide different kinds of grants. So the impact also that is pursued can also affect the formula. What kind of impact are we looking for? Employability, some kind of entrepreneurial assistance. We want to facilitate cross-border investments. We want to help a particular sector and help, let's say, employment in a particular sector, create and culture talent in general. These are can be different kind of impact related reasons, but I'm going to interrupt this slide and probably stop sharing this and share something else that might also make things a little more interesting. So allow me to share. Done. This one. So a characteristic of an ecosystem is the availability of funds. Again, I'll give you two examples from the ecosystems that were heavily involved in Bulgaria and Greece. This is the fund of funds, is a mechanism sponsored by EIF and European Investment Bank that provides funding in order to create funding mechanisms. That's why it's called fund of funds. Okay, so the mechanisms can be funded upon application. You know, they will apply for that kind of funding to create a fund. And that fund, based on its investment thesis, will provide monetary assistance to certain startups in that ecosystem under certain rules. In Greece, we have something similar called the Equifunds. Now, Equifund is again a fund of funds that combines money from the Greek government and the EU, usually the European Investment, EIF or the European Investment Bank, combined with investments from private money. That means private institutions like a bank or angel investors who want to contribute money to that same pot. So the fund that is created to help startups will get some money from the equity fund, maybe 80 or 90 or up to 90%, which is public money, and 10, 20, 30% private money. And combined, they will create the monetary force to support startups in three windows. We see the innovation window, the early stage window, and the growth stage window. The innovation window is about very early stage startups that are probably in prototype or a little after prototype stage. maybe they have some kind of early traction, early customers or early users. So these are mechanisms that can help an ecosystem grow, okay? And this is how they work. We have some kind of central money flow that distributes capital to funding entities, and the funding entities do what? Supply capital down the value chain to startups. Relative or different mechanisms for the creation of monetary players exist in many different countries, and they operate not necessarily with this way, but with similar or different ways. Exploring the ecosystem in order to understand how to design an acceleration that meets the needs requires a lot of background work. This is Startup Genome. This is the website. Maybe you can see the website, Startup Genome. Now, Startup Genome does a lot of work in order to explore the ecosystem and find all the parameters that characterize each ecosystem in every country. You can go and also read the reports that are vertical specific, that means they address the needs of particular markets, or they address any particular country in specific. So there are quite a lot of ratings. They compare countries, how mature the ecosystem is, et cetera, et cetera. So this is also a very significant and useful tool to start not just comparing ecosystems, but also understanding ecosystems. One of the most common problems that we face in developing ecosystem in developing ecosystems is the lack of enough understanding of how the ecosystem works. What are the different facilitators and how they are combined? So sometimes many of the facilitators, many of the mentors, many of the organizers have, you know, all the nice positive power and will to help their local ecosystem, but they lack the knowledge. So before we start designing a program, we need to understand how ecosystems work. And do not necessarily, as we say, copy and paste, you know, the parameters we found and read in one program in a different country to our country, because maybe the local parameters do not apply in our country. We have to understand, decrypt, and filter those that can actually be applied and be meaningful and useful when we apply, when we design something similar. Ecosystems can also be helped by other initiatives. I explored recently and discovered TUMO, which is quite interesting in Armenia. I'm quite confident you know about TUMO, which is to me a very interesting program. I don't know much and I cannot judge it because, you know, I haven't seen that in person. But I'm really curious to understand how it works. But what we understood, and this was very interesting, is that it's the concept of trying to build the ecosystem not just from bottom up, but also very, very early by helping young kids understand creative technologies early enough and assign them to the right or a more appropriate mindset in order to be able to use creative tech technologies for their benefit. Those initiatives can also help a much more medium to longer term impact in an ecosystem. When ecosystems also develop, I'm not sponsoring any company or anyone in specific, but I'm giving you indicative examples from my own exploration. We found this also company that does what? It helps other companies outsource software production in Armenia, okay? And I'm using Armenia as one indicative example since we have students from there. I don't have enough examples from all the countries. So I'm just saying this is indicative. One way that ecosystems are developed is to attract in an indirect or even direct way the supply of projects. So when you have competent programmers, for an example, competent engineers, you can attract projects. And with that project, you don't only attract contracts, but you also attract mentality. And little by little, you create some kind of culture. In Bulgaria, for an example, what happened was that in the last 20 years, and because they had very Bulgaria has or had, it's changing now, low salary wages. It managed to, but on the same time, they offered quite a good and competent degree of applied scientists. They attracted a lot of enterprise software development. And with enterprise software development, outsourced contracts, the creation of enterprise software mentality was gradually created. And that helped to the creation of a very strong, very vivid ecosystem of software engineers in the country. Now, as I said in the previous, in the slide that was describing how we synthesize the formula of an acceleration program, I also said that an acceleration program has also to understand what kind of reach and also funding resources it will submit. For an example, this is ABC Accelerator. ABC Accelerator is based in Slovenia. They run successfully for quite a few years. And to the extent that I know, they claim to be the best acceleration program in South Central Europe. Now, they have managed to attract companies from 30 different countries. They're quite competent and they offer some limited funding and of course other resources. This is the 14th batch running right now. So that means they run their program 14 times. And I think they run like twice a year. I'm not sure. I think it's twice a year. It's quite a good program. Another program that operates in a different way, it's like a combination of an acceleration program and a VC fund is from Vitus Adventures. Vitus Adventures was also funded by the Fund of Funds of Bulgaria and accelerates companies in Bulgaria. Now, as I said at the beginning, if you remember, I mentioned that the geographical reach is also important. Why is it important? Because not all funds, let's say if a startup is looking for funding through an acceleration program, the startup and of course the startup organizers need to know if they can actually provide funding for the startup. For an example, fund of funds programs or sponsor programs that are run by governments typically have restrictions that relate the availability of funding with the establishment of the startup in a party in the country that the program runs. So for an example, in this case, the program can provide funding to startups that are based in Bulgaria. So if a company from Greece, let's say, wants to get funded, they have to move into Bulgaria or move at least part of their operation in that country in order to get funding. ABC is a little different because they operate with public money and not EU money. They're much more flexible to accept companies that are not based, let's say, in Slovenia. In this case, we have another program called Berlin Startup School, and they also provide funding to companies, but also one the companies to be based in, to come into Berlin. Now, this program also has a startup school, It's called Startup Academy. And the academy runs for 3 to 4 months, offering courses in order to prep the early stage startup. And later, when that finishes, they offer, they make a selection in their demo day, and they have what they call the accelerator. And they invite companies to follow in their acceleration program that runs for 6 more months. So we can understand that there are different kinds of recipes for programs. And actually, here is one, here is in Greece. It's called Archimedes, and it's run by one of the local universities here in Athens. And it does not provide funding, but has done quite a good work with mentoring, training, etc., and has helped quite a few teams. To be honest, some of those teams we manage also to attract in our other company called Anthology Ventures. So there are different kinds of acceleration programs, some of them that are that provide money, others that don't provide money, and depending on how the program is regulated, they can accept startups from other places or not. So coming back to that other slide that we started with, and I'll return now again and share that screen again. Second. There it is. And we have more parameters to evaluate in order to fine-tune the formula. So it's not just the maturity of the ecosystem, it's not just the geography, it's not just the specialization, not the funding, the kind of impact we're looking, but also the availability of resources to operate. And this is probably one of the most challenging things, especially when we cannot offer money. Most of the acceleration programs today around, actually not most, almost half, a little bit over than half, offer some kind of monetary assistance to the startups that participate in those programs. But the rest, the other half, do not. Does it make those other half of the programs less important or less useful? No, it's not the money that makes the difference, but it's the type of result that the program can achieve for the startup that is supposed to participate in the program. It's a matter of matchmaking and timing, in other words. So many times in early ecosystems, the resources to attract, to create a program are very, very limited. But that does not mean you cannot do much. When we started as ecosystem players to support and try to create our local ecosystem, we started in Greece. We started in Greece back in the days of the beginning of the famous Greek economic crisis, and it was not good at all. I'm telling you, our resources were very limited, and we had to create and foster the creation of the entrepreneurial ecosystem. I'll show you, I'll share now a couple of screenshots from our history as for you to understand. So let me do that. Is. So when we started in 2013, actually started in 2010 as Innovation Farm. In 2013, we were trying before, until 2018, we were trying to learn how acceleration programs work. And there were not as many examples, and there was not much know-how in the local ecosystem. In 2013, we ran our first acceleration program called Stage One. And we were very happy. We launched that in Thessaloniki, Greece, and it went really well. We employed lots of mentors. We had 20 teams back then. And I'm telling you, we did a lot of mistakes in order to have that program run. We offered very, very basic training about entrepreneurship and lots of mentoring. All of us who supported the program have some kind of entrepreneurial and business experience with different backgrounds. And all together, in a complementary way, we were able to run the program that, of course, offered mostly knowledge and experience. Later on, as we moved forward, we managed to run more programs. By 2014, we ran more than five programs, three in a respective number of cities, plus two boot camps. But we also tried to run a stage one corporate stage one. By the end of 2014, we managed to run it six times in general by making experiments and also try to facilitate the need of mentor evolution. Because one of the problems that we discovered, we didn't have enough competent mentors to support all the programs that we were doing. So at the end, we managed to run stage one until 2016, the early 16, about 12 times. And then stage one gave its place to stage two, where we tried to get more advanced teams and evolve them to the next phase. Even then, as we were trying to evolve ourselves and help our local ecosystem evolve, we understood that Greece was not big enough. It was a very small market. So we thought that we should explore more and more the ecosystem for opportunities and try also to consolidate the different powers that reside in different countries and look the region as a whole, but not the country as a whole. Our next step was to create Anthology Ventures was the product of that experience of running quite a few programs. What we did was the creation of a parallel incubator where we were incubating both business angels and startups. So as you can see, as we started in 2010, moved 2013 with stage one, went to stage two, and now we are also operating an angel studio. This is an example, a typical example, also very empirical, that I can share with you of how we evolved our own company. Now we operate two companies. One is Anthology Ventures that, as I said, supports both startups and a business angel, and one is Anthology Management that helps ecosystems grow. And this is what I'm trying to share with you. A very important thing for also for the development, for the further development of your an assistant of your efforts is to be able to adopt certain tools. This is Deal Room. Deal Room offers some free services. You can have access to it by making a profile and understanding local ecosystems regarding the distribution of startups, investors, and very, very interesting statistics. I urge you to explore it. It's really, really interesting. But if you want to buy it, you better have a lot of resources because it doesn't go cheap. A much more practical tool that we also use is Crunchbase. That is more accessible. It's quite cheaper, but it's very good and offers good information about ecosystems and their startups and investors. Is Crunchbase. We use this in order to get intelligence behind who the startup founders are, what are the funding grounds and the competitor behind each startup, et cetera, et cetera. Another tool that we used as we were trying to grow and apply modern tools to organize our startup acceleration was Gust. Gust has also very good tools for you to use. One of those is Gust for Accelerators. It's free. It's really useful. You can create a profile of your program in Gust, use it for free, and have all the application process run through it. So you can have a nice, perfect tool without necessarily paying anything to help you with all the admissions. Now, why I'm telling you this? I'm telling you this because when we started, we had absolutely no resources. So we had to find tools that were ready available. They were free. They didn't require any budget in order to facilitate our first programs. And let me go again to the PowerPoint. Now I change again to the PowerPoint slide. So other constraints that we have to apply in order to find the acceleration formula has to do with the costs. We'll deal with the costs later on, probably tomorrow, or maybe touch it today a little bit. When you run a program, one of the very first things that you have to be very specific is about the cost orientation and the profit orientation. One thing is sure, there is a cost. I'm not sure about the profit, but cost, there is always one. And most of the times the cost is greater than what is calculated originally. So understanding the cost parameters is critical to have a very successful program. Believe me, without putting down the costs very well, you might find yourself before unpleasant surprises that you don't want to face. It's like having a company that runs without a budget, without costing its product or service. Don't do it without costing it. Now, if you want to have a profit, that is a decision you need to make. Because profit means you have to make a company, a for-profit company. If you don't want profit, at least you have to have the right money supply to adequately cover all the expenses that the running the program will have. Now, as you can see, there are quite a lot of parameters to take into account before you start an acceleration program, but the most important parameter is the goal of the program, what we want to achieve. We don't want to run a program because it's a good thing. We want to run the program, and it's a good thing to when you run the program, not because it's a good thing, but because we have something specific in our mind. We want to grow the ecosystem, but growing the ecosystem is also wishful thinking. When we grow the ecosystem means that we have to be very specific on how we're going to grow the ecosystem and in what time depth, how much time we have available, 1 year, 2 years, 3 months, what kind of outcome can we achieve in that time? So, and what is the specific goal? Talent creation, employability, companies, investments. These are four different things, not the same, interrelated, but not the same. So with this, I believe we can have a short break and return in, let's say 10 minutes. Right now it is 10 to 6. I believe we can come back at 6 o'clock and continue with the lecture. What do you think?
Okay.
All right. So, see you in Inter.
Okay.
Hello again. We'll begin in a minute. So I don't know how many of you are on behind the closed mics and cameras, but as I think I asked at the beginning, but maybe rephrase, has anyone here attempted to advise, even informally, a startup that came to you in any moment during your professional life or at any given moment? To ask for help?
No.
Yes?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. So, are you back here? I'd like to know if there are a few of us here. So I can start with the presentation. Hello? It's kind of lonely.
Just everyone has switched off the microphones. Maybe
yes,
that's why
their voices
are not heard. Maybe
yeah,
that's
they're
why.
Muted also. So I will continue. I would like to know that we have people here present. Well, either way, I have to proceed. So I hope you're back and you're just muted. So let me continue. I'll share my screen again. Please let me know if you can see my screen now?
Yes, we can see, yeah.
Thank you. So, is there anyone here with some kind of a business background? Anyone here, business background? Okay. So, before we put together all the parameters, and after assessing all the previous things I just mentioned, an analysis of the landscape of the different programs can help the startup organizers, but also not the startup organizers, but also the startups per se, understand how the market, how the different facilitators compare with each other. But also if there is a gap in the market of these acceleration programs or boot camps or startup competitions and how they relate to it. I have to tell you that it's not a surprising thing that certain startups leapfrog from one program to the other. And many times we call this startup tourism, which is not necessarily the best thing. Sometimes it's good to repeat courses if startups provide a lot of lectures, but also get different angles, different mentoring angles from different mentors from all the programs. But also too much acceleration can also dilute the effort of the startup and cannot necessarily be the right thing. So in any case, we have to also be careful of how much acceleration we provide. Now, all the ecosystems today have either less or other more or way more offerings, service offerings for startups. But how we compare them? Well, if we change our viewing angle and understand and interpret that a startup incubator or a startup accelerator is a company offering services, and the startups are the clients, we have a give and take relationship. So the givers, the companies, equal that in our case are the accelerators, will have to, you know, compete with each other. In company terms, we compare companies with a competition matrix, an analysis where we place in a matrix all the different competitors and compare those, compare particular company attributes or product elements, service elements with each other, and understand if there is a gap or stronger and or weaker points during this comparison. So a competition analysis in this case is also important for both the startup organizers to make a differentiated, useful program to offer to their startup ecosystem, local, countrywide, regional, okay? And for the startups to understand what are their options, okay? So how this matrix looks? Well, this matrix looks like that. And in an ecosystem, we can compare its main players. We don't necessarily have to compare all the players, but sometimes 3 to 5 players that you indirectly or directly compete to get the best talent, attract the best talent to your program. This is how a matrix could look like. So on one hand, we have what? We have different kinds of program offerings, can be different acceleration programs, can be different competition or boot camps. We have programs that run by universities, programs that are that combine a university and some kind of a company, let's say the medical school of the ex-university and a private clinic together can run a program, a competition that is run either by a university or a private accelerator, a VC accelerator, or a company, okay? Or a municipality that is sector agnostic or can be very, 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 very targeted. And of course, all the different acceleration programs that can be, you know, matchmakers, funded, you name it, ecosystem builders. So having all the programs that we want to compare, or the different facilitators on this left column, we can assign values based on how strong different of their attributes look to us. And this is, of course, very subjective, but we have to begin. It's better having a subjective analysis, or if you don't want to assign value, just mark it with an X and don't give any value, but you at least have a depiction of all those characteristics altogether. So what can we compare? We compare different elements, the main elements of the programs. What are the main elements? Let's say how strong or how competitive is their admission process. That means, you know, anyone who can apply can get in. Maybe there is and should be some kind of a filter to not only to approve those who want to participate in the competition, accept them in the program, but also have some kind of uniform level, because you cannot have someone, let's say, who is too advanced, have, let's say, 2 years of traction and client, and someone is just in the PowerPoint idea of how to make the product, how to get into the market. Those two are very unequal things to put together in the same program. So the admission process, also the admissions length, let's say how long should the admission process, let's say 15 days, 1 month, 2 months, depends. And that also relates to how big and how strong your communication effort is expected to be, because you need to make all the startups and the audience you want to address aware. And that typically requires time. If you offer funding or not. Typically, all startups, 99% of them will say, we want funding. This is our need. That's why we join the program. But if it was that easy, we would offer funding to all the startups. We wouldn't bother offering mentoring, and everyone will be happy. But it doesn't work this way. Basically, out of 100 startups, the ones that are ready and able to absorb money, not ask, but absorb money and implement all the monetary inflow in a productive way are less than 30% of the 100%. And this is a very, this is an experiential outcome. If we offer our competition in a sector agnostic or a vertical way, can also profile the program and become one of the main elements of it. Let's say we have a sector agnostic program, we have something just for the fintech. If we receive equity for whatever monetary value we offer, or not necessarily monetary value, that can also become of the main characteristics of the program. But it's not just the main elements, there are also other things that characterize an acceleration process. It's how the process itself is happening. For an example, many acceleration programs have one or two-step processes, or even if they don't have, they usually have some kind of interim cut of startups. And that is the reason, because they don't want to end up, let's say, with all 50 applicants they start the program with, but probably with 10, okay? A short list of the big list that they began the program with. So during that acceleration process, the many will become few, they turn into few. Those few will be, let's say, the most competent in the Darwinian way that we explained before, to graduate the program. But what's happening in the one-step or two-step acceleration process is also part of the design of the program. Because the from admissions to one step, and from one step to the second step, and the second step to a demo day probably, it's a funnel that as you advance towards the future, the startups will have to adapt, and the process become much more rigorous and more demanding. And that affects the Darwinian evolution. So only some should be able to proceed. Now, with that, I'm not saying that this is always the case, that you should not have a program that anyone can graduate, but because it's called acceleration program, by default, it's very hard for all of them to be able to follow through and continue equally successfully in every step of the program. It's quite hard to achieve that. So most of them, maybe half, will not be able to accelerate themselves equally well until the last phase of the program. Another thing that is also part of the design of the program is what kind of structure the program will have. Will it include mentoring, and how much? Will it include seminars or mini events? Maybe all of them, but in what recipe? You can have a program that's 100% mentoring, no seminars, just advice from the beginning to the end of the program or the end of the day, right? If it is a competition, you can infuse seminars, but how many of them? Let's say 30% of the time is seminars, 50%. Maybe the whole program is just seminars, but is this what the startups want? They want, you know, another second life of academia? Maybe yes, maybe no. Again, that depends on what? The goal of the program. If the goal of the program is just to educate, maybe you have to have lots of seminars there to provide the right amount of know-how, okay, for the participating startups. If it's not just, you know, theoretical background and we need something more, then you have to infuse much more mentoring proportionally or disproportionately more compared to the seminar time allocated. And again, mini events. In mini events, you can probably host externals, let's say advisors, executives, people from companies who can come and share their expertise, their experience from running their businesses with the startups. Last but not least is the growth and impact element of the acceleration program. That consists from the demo day. And what the demo day should do with growth? Well, the demo day by default is a more extroverted element of the acceleration program. And this is and that because in the demo day, we invite people to see the results of the program. And besides that, we also invite them to, if we want to invite investors, to see if we have done a nice work there and if there is also an opportunity for them to look favorably to it or not. Corporate support can also be part of the growth and impact element of an accelerator, because with partnering a company, let's say a telecom or any other company that can provide know-how or access to the market for particular startups and can also be very, very helpful. A much more advanced corporate involvement is to do with a proof of concept, POC. So sometimes participating companies do not only provide consultation, but they offer offer themselves as to become the test bed for the participating startups. So a participating startup can test the technology where within the protected and controlled environment of the supporting company, who can also sponsor the program and offer proof of concept opportunity for the startup. Last but not least, of course, has to do with the impact focus, okay? So what kind of impact we want? They would say employability, creating jobs, creating new companies, fostering the spirit of entrepreneurship, something, okay? Creating investable cases. All those are different goals for a program. And depending on who the startup organizers are, you can adjust those goals and create the right recipe that fits your purpose. So if you assign all those values, you can have, let's say, an outcome. You can see all those four categories, main elements, process, structure, and growth and impact summarized here. And you can have the synopsis of the main competitors that you want to, you know, step into that same market area of startup facilitation and attract the best talent for your effort. It's always a nice thing to compare, as we do with companies. We do a competition analysis, the same thing. The startups can also do it. I believe it is a very useful exercise, not only for the startup organizers, but you know, to give it to the startups to do, as they not only, you know, do something academic, but because they have to explore in a structured way, you provide, you know, the tool to acquire the mindset to compare and know what exactly to pay attention when they log into a website and say this acceleration program, that university, or that acceleration program is run by the company, that competition that offers this and that. They can, by doing this exercise, they can really understand how to decrypt the benefits that are behind the promises. So it's quite useful. We have prepared this tool, and we can distribute it to for you to use. I believe it's going to help you a lot with your students or any startups you engage with, or if you are a startup, or if you have any representative for any startup with us that is looking for programs, we can supply this tool and, you know, and be able to see what happens when you assign values. By the way, do we have any startup among us tonight?
No.
Probably yes or no, I wasn't sure about that anyway. Okay, so let's see something that follows. It has to do with acceleration program design. What we saw about the ecosystem. We saw the different players. We understand we have to depict the ecosystem, understand what's happening, rate the different programs, but how we design a program. Well, in order to design a program, we have to understand its main constraints. So who the acceleration program above all targets, okay? Who can be a target to that? If the goal is to, let's say, create investable companies, that means companies that are could potentially start raising money after the end of the program in, let's say, 6 or 7 months, we need to find companies that are not, let's say, in PowerPoint stage, because those PowerPoint companies will not be invested in 6 months. Okay, it's very, very premature. They need other kind of help. So in our criteria, we have designed the program in such a way that we exclude companies that are in a very early stage. If we want to build a program that will start fostering the spirit of entrepreneurship, then we can accept earlier stage companies. If we want to build a program that wants to attract foster medical technology, for an example, we have to filter the application and the profile in order to attract that kind of a talent. What is the main promise to the participating startups? We'll get you money. We'll fine-tune your project. We'll give you a test bed to test your prototype. Okay, this is also a very critical, maybe the most critical thing of the program, because the main promise we can give to the startup is related directly to the goal of the program. The goal of the program and the promise to the startup should be probably matching. Okay. So based on the target, that means the target participants, and the promise to the startups, we have to define what kind of service we will serve in order to be able to implement that promise. So if we said we want to offer you a proof of concept opportunity to test your prototype, we better have a place or the capabilities for proof of concept. Now, be very careful. In sector agnostic acceleration programs that you invite like everyone, someone who can have a marketplace to sell clothes, or someone who is a life science company that helps in the development of drugs, or someone who is developing 5G technologies, it's very hard to support all those different needs in proof of concept, help them with prototypes. So if you really want to help them with the prototype testing, then you better be much more focused. Let's say find one area that you can do well, find the right sponsors in that particular industry sector that can support proof of concept and target that. So try not to combine sector agnostic with proof of concept capabilities unless you are quite confident you can find all the right partners that can help those startups and the promise that you suggested is fulfilled. So again, the services of the program are directly related to the promise that we give. What is the product, the program's duration? Again, that also is related to what? Related to what kind of goal we have and what, how much time that goal needs in order to be covered. For an example, in proof of concept, there is more time needed in order to test the product, get feedback, make corrections. If your goal is to accelerate the education, the business education, and if you want to make a program that is going to give the basics to entrepreneurs that have no much of a business background, then you need to devote more time in mentoring. If you want to combine both, okay, then you have to have a much more extended duration of the program. If you don't have enough resources to communicate frequently and to get the right coverage of the program in terms of how many people need to learn about it, how many times they need to hear about it in order to remember it, and end up all this reads and convert to applications and good ones, that you want good ones to run a successful program, you have to account also for a long admission period. How much is that? Definitely not 15 days. You might have to have an admission period of 2 months, especially in ecosystems that the founders, the startup founders don't have, let's say, the mentality, they don't know where to look. I remember a few months ago, we consulted a regional incubator here in Greece, and we told them that, you know, you need more time to attack more talent, because at that particular region, the startup mentality was not as developed as it was in the big metropolis. But, you know, they kept that period very short, and the applications were not as many as they kind of hoped. So that meant that quite a few of the applicants actually got accepted in the program. That story would be probably different if a bigger number of applicants were before the door of the accelerator. So the screening committee would probably have to filter the same probably amount of startups in, but select from a much bigger pool. So again, the duration is subject to quite a few things, starting from the ecosystem and how, what kind of communication effort is required, to the type of services offered within the program. Okay. In that context also, we have to take into account what happens after the program. If there is post-acceleration services there, well, what can be a post-acceleration service? Post-acceleration service can be funding or some kind of due diligence or some kind of prototype options if they are not offered within the acceleration program, but you offer them after. If you remember what we saw in the example before of that Berlin accelerator that offers academic program 3 months and 6 months acceleration. So the total program basically is 9 months long. So it's not quite short as some people many times think. Another important factor, who are going to be the program's implementers? Because someone has to run that thing. Okay, no matter how well we design, we have to find the players. You have to have the players beforehand, before you announce it. Unfortunately, we have seen quite a few examples where acceleration programs are announced and the mentors or advisors are found on the way. This is not right. And this is not right because the promise that we said we have to keep is in danger. And we don't, it's not a good thing not to keep your promise, especially to the startups. It's important to have all the basic facilitators, the internal at least, that are important to run the program in place, and committed. Committed means that they will actually do what they promise to do. They're not cosmetic. They are committed. It's a different thing. So who will be the program implementers? Are you going to have, let's say, more resident mentors, people who will work in the program for and commit for, let's say, 3 months? Or you're going to be based to run the program based on external advisors who will support the program in any time left they have? And I'm not saying they will not do a good job, but it's a different thing. So time commitments and keeping the schedule straight can also affect the quality of the program. And that needs to be planned ahead of time and not be, you don't need to discover America, you know, on the way until the end of the program. Critical, what comes next? Who will be the program's partners? Now, the partners, again, like internal facilitators, need to be very real and non-cosmetic. Many times we see in programs too many logos of companies or institutions that do not necessarily do much. What is important for the program's success is to have the right committed partners. If you have a partner who will offer its infrastructure to become the test bed, then that partner is to be committed. If that partner is offering, let's say, some communication assistance to go out and reach as many people as and attract as many talent, okay, this needs to be also agreed, not only in terms of what the partner will do, but also how we'll do it. Okay, so we need to have specific commitments there. If you want a partner to supply with mentors, external mentors, then you have to sign a contract with a partner that will supply you the right mentors and how those mentors will work in that program. There are programs that do not use their own mentors. They hire mentors that are supplied by third parties. It's not a bad thing, but you have to have commitment in that case. So this is also a critical element of the program. Now, aside startup funding, that is in many times very important for most of the startups, there are other costs that depending on the country, because not all countries have the same labor cost per hour, or what the program is promised, the cost might range between $2,000 and $50,000 per startup. The fact that some people, you know, are not getting paid, that does not mean that there is no cost for the program. Okay, there is non-monetary value assigned, and there are always costs. So when you set up a program, it's good to have a very, very well depicted budget to go with it and understand what are the obvious and what are the hidden costs of the that program that you are about to run. It's really, really important to have this. Now, let's see how we can design a product, an acceleration program. And we have developed a very easy module here that we can follow where we can improve it a little more, but we'll give for you to access it, to have the basic elements at least pictured in. Sorry, hold on. I'm gonna go here, skip that. We'll see that later. So in order to design the program, we have to understand if it's going to have certain phases, okay? So are we gonna have a consequent pre-acceleration and acceleration steps? One step. The admission process, interim selection process, and how we're going to distribute the available resources to fewer teams can affect the resource allocation and affect the design. So here is an example that we can see some kind of a program design where we have what? On the top row, we have the number of weeks, per phase. Okay, let's say here in the second column from the left to right, we have what? We have the admission period, okay? And we have, let's say, three different programs, a non-investing, an investing one, and an investing one with proof of concept that we are considering in running. So what we do here is we try to see which elements we want to include in each type of a program and how much time that thing might also take its phase. For an example, an admission period could involve the admission period per se as a sub phase, the screening or first evaluation. For an example, what is the screening and first evaluation? We have an acceleration form that someone needs to submit. Okay, this is your first screening phase. You accept all the application line. I saw you at the beginning of today's seminar, GAST, and GAST can offer you an application. We can also create your own and design, implement your own. So how long is it gonna take you to screen the applications? Maybe 2 weeks. Screen all the applications, examine all the material. Some of you might also require not just an application, but also this for the startup to do what? To submit supplementary material. So instead of filling up application, you might ask for a pitch deck, financial plan, a Gantt chart, any other things, if they have a founder's agreement or whatever, in case how advanced your program is, and what are the requirements. It's like university admissions. Certain universities are really, really top-notch and do not accept easily their students. Some others are much more open and have less requirements. The same thing with the acceleration programs. So they might be harder or easier to get in. But don't be fooled and say, you know, I want all the best, because maybe the ecosystem is not ready to support. You don't have all the right quantity to convert to the right match for your program. So the second screening and evaluation has to do with interviews. Okay, are you gonna have an interview process there? How long is going to last? And so you might have a first stage, we check the application, second phase, we do interviews. That's the admission period. In this example, the admission period might last in total 11 weeks. Then the acceleration starts. And in this example, we have pre-acceleration. So the pre-acceleration has to do with its first part of pre-acceleration, when you have some kind of interim control, you do whatever you need to do, mentoring, advising, and you have interim control points where you check the progress of all the pre-accelerated teams, okay? So why we do that interim control? We do the interim control to check the work of the mentors. We do the interim control to check the outcome of the startup work, whatever they do, working with their business concept, with the market research, with the competition analysis, whatever we want them to do in the pre-acceleration phase. And those interim controls will help us also do what? Apply the Darwinian process. So as we have more in the beginning, we end up with fewer at the end. So as we move forward the pre-acceleration, towards the end of the pre-acceleration, we have to have some kind of a cut. So apply a process that will say, okay, out of you, let's say 20 who got in the pre-acceleration program, 10 will pass in the next phase, which is the acceleration. Okay. Most probably you might need to be unpleasant for some of the startups that might not get to proceed to the next phase, but this is how things are. And they should be, if you ask me, a little, not strict, but demanding. It should be demanding because life, entrepreneurial life, is very demanding. And if they fail, if they need to face some difficulty, it's better to face that difficulty here in a protective way that they don't have to incur and pay all the bills, because later on the bills start. Okay. and you're not going to pay the bills for them. They will have to pay the bills for themselves. So it's better to, you know, to assign the degree of seriousness and risk. So it's good to have something to lose at the end, not just win. Then in the acceleration process, you can repeat the same sequence, but of course, with different topics. You are not going to do the same topics that you did in the acceleration period. You have to do, let's say, other topics. Let's say, let's see now that after you have succeeded with validating your solution need, and you have your concept ready and everything, let's see how you're going to implement now. Let's see how you're going to design the prototype, what kind of resources you need. Let's see your business model. Let's examine your financial plan. And of course, your long-term vision. Okay, there are startups that, you know, are non-scalable startups that want to become viable companies, which is perfectly okay. There are other startups that want to become scalable, exitable startups. So they want to sell themselves, you know, to an exit. You know, the founders want to exit, let's say, 5 or 7 years down the road. What is their plan? Are they raising investment or not? So all those things can happen in a more advanced phase of the acceleration process. And this is where you again have to apply some kind of screening. For an example, this is a very critical question. And there is no right or wrong, I'm telling you, no right or wrong. It's a matter of goal of the program and the promise, of course, that you made. So all the graduates of the acceleration program, of the acceleration phase, can pitch in a demo day that follows. The demo day is the final exhibition where the startups that survive the acceleration and this Darwinian process can pitch to investors or some kind of other business audiences. Can and should they all pitch in the demo day? It's a critical question. Regarding how well the program goes and what kind of outcome you have to take that serious decision, maybe or not, make someone happy or unhappy. So you have to have some kind of screening at the end of the acceleration period and prepare them for the demo day. Okay? So theoretically, an acceleration program can stop there at the demo day, after the demo day, if you have a demo day, because it's not necessarily a mandatory thing. But certain programs have post-acceleration period, or they begin a second, even more advanced acceleration period. So there is a back-to-back acceleration here, okay? So what do they do? Let's, for an example, if you want to offer some kind of investment-ready startups at the end, you invite, or if you are an investing acceleration program, you give money, then you can, out of those who pitched, make a final selection. Let's say out of those 10 that managed to pitch, 5 go to and offer an investment or facilitate an investment by offering a term sheet, doing some kind of a due diligence, and finally applying some kind of an investment. Now, these are indicative phases and sub-phases for an acceleration program. Again, you might have a single period, or maybe 2 or 3 periods, or have one single acceleration program that succeeds another acceleration program that has different goals, but succeeding goals, not irrelevant, succeeding goals. And in this way, you can design your resources. Your resources are not going to be endless, I'm telling you. No matter how many you have, they're not going to be endless. So some people will have to devote a lot of time mentoring. Others will have to devote a lot of time supporting, analyzing different kind of business plan, babysitting, holding hands for the founders, and of course, be able to keep yourself, your state of mind, because engaging with startups is not just a business process. It's a social process. So direct relationship with people, human relationships are developed. there is a lot of emotional load that you have to be able to withstand, keep balance, and also have the right distance, not too far, not too close, has to be objective. This is a very, very demanding challenge for most of the startup organizers, but even more for the startup mentors who get direct contact with all the supported startups. So summarizing this, you have, let's say, three types of programs compared to the period they have. As you can see, there is a difference in time in this example between the investing, non-investing, or when you provide a proof of concept. Usually proof of concept programs require a little more time because they actually apply, the startup teams typically apply their prototype to actual clients or actual users within the program, even if they don't have in the beginning. And although the program might last, let's say, how many weeks, the actual engagement with the startups, because the program includes also the admission period, might be less proportionally regarding, and has to do with what kind of program that you plan to implement. Before I move forward, I would like, hold on, let me stop sharing here. I'd like to know if there is any question so far.
No questions. Just I want to thank you for the very interesting and informative information. It's very useful. By the way, I am a lecturer at Yerevan in Armenia, at Yerevan Budista State University, and I teach in the Department of PR, so public relations. I teach ESP, but nonetheless, this course, a training course, is very useful. I get a lot of information and I can improve my knowledge and teach better in this case. So that's why it's very interesting for me. Thank you.
You're very welcome. I hope it is actually helpful. And if you need any help with with the content that you feel that you we could be very, we could provide assistance, we'll be more than happy to do it. Is there anyone else who could probably benefit directly from this material? Okay, or the students that you teach? Okay, I will proceed. It's 10 to 7. So actually it's time for our next break. So I'm going to have a break right here and continue in around 10 minutes. We'll be back and continue with the webinar. So see you in around 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
For those who came in just now, we will continue in 2 minutes. We're taking all of a break now. Hello, hope you're back. We'll begin now our last part of today's session. So I will share my screen. We were discussing before about different elements that we have to include when we design an acceleration program. We explain how we separate those elements and how we think when we put them together. And now I would like to share an exercise with you. We'll do it in real time right now. I'm gonna actually do it for you, so you'll see. And I can share that spreadsheet. You can also use it if you want to put the main ingredients together. It's an alternative way of what you just showed. So let me share it, if I may. So this is about program design. It can help you put some details in the program of yours. So let us assume that you want to design a program for your ecosystem, right? Now, the right thing to do, as I said in the beginning, is go and compare the different elements of your ecosystem. So By using this, you can apply whatever value is applicable in any comparable program or competition or bootcamp find in the ecosystem. Okay, these are random values here. And by doing that, we can have, let's say, a map of the ecosystem. An alternative way, just confirm that you can see my spreadsheet. Please, one person I need to know that you see my spreadsheet. Do you see my spreadsheet?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
thank you. Okay, thank you. So the other thing, that same module you can use in order by assigning values from 0 to 3, depending on the strength of the, let's say, of the element that you want to compare. And at the end, you have a good depiction of the ecosystem that you compare its players, all right? Now, having done the comparison, you can set some kind of basic program design that you want to do to serve the goal. As I said, the goal that is very important for you to have. So let's go to program design. For an example, let us assume that we want to create a program that is going to offer basic acceleration. Actually, not very basic, a little above the basic acceleration, combined mentoring and seminars to startups that have to do with mobility and the environment, okay? So this is not a sector agnostic acceleration program, does not offer funding, but also wants to combine mentoring and seminars. So if we have done our math, if we've done our research of the ecosystem, well, we know how big the ecosystem is, how many startups there are. For example, if there is a way, there is a kind of startup registry, if you can go and look to different applications, to different programs, how many people applied, or ask the other startup organizers how many applications they received when they did the program and when they did, because the ecosystem is generally mature, so you might have more startups on the way. You can set up your benchmark and say, okay, out of this, out of my ecosystem, which is developing, okay, in this climate, mobility and energy, I might have up to, let's say, 80 applicants. This is my target. I would like to receive 80 applications, okay? 80 applications. Now, I'm not going to admit them all, right? So I'm going to have, let's say, an acceptance rate, and I would like out of those 80, to accept, let's say, 15%. That means my targeted admissions will be 12. Now, that of course relate to how many applications I expect to have, but I also have to have a roof. So that means my program can run, but we can support no more than 15 companies that we admit in, but not more. So if I receive, let's say, 120 applications, I cannot get 18 in, or so someone might not get the cut. So we have to have some kind of cutoff point, regardless of what is the targeted admissions rate in that program. So let's say we have 100, we reach with 15% admission rate, we reach our roof, which is 15 startups admitted in the acceleration process. Now, another thing that we have to keep down, I need to design, I need to know, it's another marker, is how many days I need to respond and decline, and of course accept the rest for those who have admitted since the announcement. It's the deadline. So let's say I have, since the announcement of the program, 45 days, okay? 45 days, I announce it in the press, I have the website ready, I'm saying we're open, we're waiting for the application. 45 days is the deadline. Another thing that we have to keep in mind when we design the program, we need to have an extended application form or not. If it is, let's say, extended, okay, we can have, so let's say yes, then the application form should have enough fields online for the startups to have, but we also need to know if we ask for additional documentation. Additional documentation can be, as we said, the pitch deck, the financial plan, an executive summary. So we have a note here. This is a notebook to how to design the program basically, and how many days we need for, you know, the decision. So after we have the screening process ready, how many days we need for the decision? Let's say 7 days to decide which to take in. Funding. Now, if we want to offer funding, you know, it's a good thing if we can, but maybe we cannot. Sometimes we can offer cascade funding. Cascade funding is offered, let's say, in certain programs that can fund the acceleration process, but part of the budget does not go to the organizer, it goes to the startup per se. That's why it's called cascade funding. It's a funding within the funding of the whole program. So in this case, let's say we don't have cascade funding. If we are a VC ourselves, we have a close relationship with some kind of a VC, then we can say that we offer VC funding. If not, we can say no, like here. If it is some kind of sponsor who offer funding that is not a VC, we can say, let's say here, we don't have any sponsor funding, nothing in grant. But what do we offer? Do we offer in-kind help? Yes, let's say we offer in-kind help. So sometimes support, besides mentoring, can come in kind. So we can have mentors or advisors working, offering their time in parallel with the acceleration or after the acceleration process is over. So let's say we have some kind of in kind help, and that in kind help can also be services of third parties. For an example, if our program is related to Microsoft or Amazon, okay, and it can provide through the program Amazon service, sometimes that the service can have some kind of monetary value, let's say 30,000 euros. Actually, this monetary value if we offer investment. So we put it here, 30,000 euros. If we offer some kind of if we offer it during admission or graduation. So if we offer monetary funding, we have to justify if the monetary help is offered at the entrance of the program or at the exit of the program. In this case, we don't offer any monetary help. We say here, no. And here we don't offer help again. We're going to say no. Again, we have to describe if our program is sector agnostic or not. This is, we say no, it's not sector agnostic. It targets mobility and energy. So it is a vertical program, excuse me. And it's in the mobility, energy, and environment. And what else? Do we take equity for this kind of in-kind investment? Let's say no. And there is no equity request because we don't take equity, let's say, in this program at all, even for in-kind investment or monetary. Is this a one-step or two-step at the acceleration program? Let's say we have two steps. So it's a no here, it's a two-step. So we say yes here. The duration of the first step in days, let's say 60 days, and another 60 days for the second step. That means that the total acceleration is 120 days, and including all the admission period and the decision-making period, it's 172 days or 25 weeks program. Now, we need to make a mark here if there is an interim cut for startups. Yes, we have, let's say, an interim cut for the startups during the program. Do we apply certain metrics? Well, in this case, What do we mean with certain metrics? When we apply interim cuts to startups, we have to have some kind of criteria. So those criteria can be qualitative progress. If they achieve certain marks, let's say they have submitted the business plan, they've finished the prototype, they have their team complete, they managed to attract talent. So all those things can be different kind of objectives that could also be quantifiable. So if we have certain milestones we want them to hit, it's okay, maybe these are criterion. So this is the overall performance. But sometimes startups can also apply particular quantitative markers. Let's say you want to increase your clients or have, let's say, your first clients by the end of the program or by the end of the first 2 months. So if you apply those certain metrics, you can say yes. Again, we said that the program is going to provide both mentoring with the resident mentors, but also going to employ visiting advisors. And here, yes, we will also have seminars. Are we going to have mini events? Let's say no. And a demo day, let's say yes. Corporate support, let's say no, because we are going to apply a very, very bare minimum kind of product with no corporate proof of concept help. But yes, we definitely have some kind of impact, and that is employability, okay? So one employability in this particular market sector we want to encourage, and this way we have all the basic ingredients of our product, of our program put together. So this is an easy way to take down our notes on how the program is going to be. But again, I'm telling you, it's much easier, and it's going to meet it, and it's going to mean more if you also apply before that the competition matrix of all different startup facilitators that are out there, and even better if you rank them before you do the program design. That means you integrate both your knowledge, that you understand you and your other program organizers what's happening out there in the location that you want to run the program before you set the parameters, and not the other way around. We set the parameters and then we see the ecosystem is good or bad. It's a wrong way to do it. I wouldn't advise you to proceed in that way. So having those things put together, we have the rough draft of a program. We know where and what to apply. Because if you don't assign random values in this spreadsheet, that means you have a good idea, let's say, how big the ecosystem is and how many applications to expect. By having done a very good analysis of the other programs, for an example here, you know what kind of support they give and what kind of support is needed. Now, because you've done the analysis though, and have someone depicting the ecosystem, the landscape, and someone doing the program design, does not necessarily mean that everything is all right. Why? Well, the answer to this is the same answer that we tell also the startups to look for. It has to do with asking the client. Like startups have to ask and talk to the clients. For that same reason, startup organizers need also to ask startups what kind of help they receive from other programs, what things they like, what things they didn't, what they were promised, and if promises were fulfilled. Because one of the things that you don't want to do is to repeat and copy-paste the mistake that another program did. Because this way we don't have evolution, we have a repetition, and a repetition of nothing productive, but the repetition of a mistake. Many programs do that, but as the ecosystems evolve and we have acceleration of startups, we also need to have what? Acceleration of the accelerators. Both mentors, advisors, startups, startup incubators, they all also need their own set, they all their own parameters of acceleration in order to evolve and also to, by evolving, offer better services for their ecosystem and not become copycats of something that is successful somewhere else, but not necessarily successful in their local environments or region. The world is somehow shrinking. It's becoming smaller and smaller because of the ability to communicate, travel faster, exchange information, collaborate, do whatever we want. That evolution affects the program per se. And that's why we have now more regional programs. And we have regional programs for what reason? Because we can attract talent from a much, much more broader geographical spectrum. By attracting talent from more broader geographical spectrum, if we can, we can also increase what? The pool of opportunity. The bigger the pool that we can attract nice startups to incubate and accelerate, the better. But that, again, on itself has to do with our goal. If our goal is to develop the local ecosystem, then we're not really interesting about the regional pool, we're interesting in the local pool. So our goal is to see how we can improve the quality of the local pool and probably the quantity over the years. It's not going to happen in the next day, but it can happen. And this is why I said in the very beginning, when we design the program, we need to understand what is the goal of the program. The goal is not to help. Help is a good motive, but it's not the goal. So let me start sharing this Excel spreadsheet for a moment. And go back to my PowerPoint. So we stop here, where we compare a program's timeline. We show how we can have a quick and dirty way to put the basic parameters in designing a program. But let us now compare how we can understand the different resource allocation in between two types of programs. One that invests in a startup and one that does not invest in a startup. If you remember, in the beginning, I told you that around half of the acceleration programs worldwide do not invest actual money, do not give monetary help to the startups, they invest in kind, okay? They offer services, they offer mentoring, and most of them do not make any money because their reason is not to make money. Others are. So in this case, we'll start comparing two different programs. And what I'll show you here is that the values are indicative, but it will give you a better understanding of the resource and the cost differences. Now, here we have what? We have a non-investing acceleration program example. An acceleration program that was created in order to help an ecosystem that does not give money, but of course has costs, okay? Someone has to pay those costs. Some subsidy, an organization sponsoring a private entity, someone, okay? Even if there are volunteers, there will be some minimum cost at least somewhere. So let's assume that this is a non-investing acceleration program and it is it has two phases, one of pre-acceleration and another one of acceleration, let's say split in half in the program. In this case, the number of participating teams, that means the teams that were accepted after the successful screening of application and interviews are 20. So we get 20 teams in the program. So what are the resources that we have to allocate? First of all, the resident mentors. Let us assume the program, again, this is an assumption, you can assign whatever value you want. Let's say you have three resident mentors that will deal with the startups in their daily routine for however long, you know, how much long that program lasts. So three resident mentors, and those resident mentors costs around 5,000 each, okay? Now, the hours per mentor or advisor, how you call them, is, let's say, 60 hours. That means that three persons will contribute 180 hours during the pre-acceleration process. This is how much, let's say, time we said we want them to allocate in general. And 50% of those hours, 50%, will take place during the acceleration process. The other 50 will come with will go to the acceleration. This is pre-acceleration. What other costs we have? We might have, let's say, 10 guest advisors, not the resident mentors, but people who invite in. Maybe they have a cost. Maybe they have a cost just to bring them, because we need to pay some traveling expenses, and they don't get paid. We have to pay them the expense to fly them in or come. So they also give some an amount of hours, each one of them, with that has, let's say, another cost, again, 50%. That costs allocated in the pre-acceleration process. We have also two mini events that we organize. We bring some speakers. We also buy drinks, small catering. Okay, so 50%, that means one event, let's say, is happening in the pre-acceleration process. We also have what? Let's say the collaboration tools, and we pay some kind of a subscription for 20 people, let's say 20 euros per team for those 20 teams that participate in 50% of them in the pre-acceleration process. And we have a total cost of 9,500 euros with this allocation tool in the pre-acceleration process. We have the amount of hours per team, allocate per team, and we also have the allocation of value for those 20 teams. So those 20 teams will be assigned with a cost of 485 euros. They were not gonna pay, okay? They're not gonna pay unless we ask for them to contribute in the cost covering. That's another option, okay? Usually very sector agnostic or very entry-level acceleration do not require money. Now, the second phase, because we have an interim cut, will accelerate half of those teams. So we had 20 at the beginning, and now we have 10. So 10 of them are out of the picture. You know, Darwin said no to the next phase. So in this case, we have the same amount of mentors, the same amount of advisors, and the same amount of tools, but allocated in less teams. So every team, because half of them is accelerating, half of them is cut, receives more value in the second phase. Okay, so in this case, we have more hours per team allocated, but also more value in the terms of costs generated to run the program allocated per team. And this is also another way to understand why it is much more right to not to have, let's say, an equal number of teams entering and exiting the program, because some of them will be better and will deserve more help. So you have to be also more just in order to allocate more resources, at least in the second phase. That's one of the reasons we typically have two phases, pre-acceleration and acceleration. It's not a matter of title. It's a matter of having an interim cut and be able, by knowing enough who has a better chance of becoming viable and having a better program to devote more time to that entity. Again, that rule also accounts and is valid for companies. Companies also have key accounts, and the best accounts usually attract more resources because they generate more value for the company. Of course, this is not exactly the same thing because we're trying to grow the ecosystem here, but the reason behind the resource allocation is exactly the same. We want to devote more resources to those who can, to those who are committed, to those who deserve the allocation of resources. Because they're in a startup ecosystem, they're also tourists, in quotes, who just spend time and are there because they like it, it's a hobby, but it's not free, okay? So you need to be also fair for those who are serious and committed to see their dream come true. This is a non-investing acceleration example, but with a particular outcome, but let's compare it with an investing acceleration example. This is different. In this case, investing acceleration programs are typically more expensive. And there is a reason, and there is a reason for that. The reason for that is to do because there is more monetary commitment. Because investing programs will, at the end, at the beginning of the program or at the exit, will actually give monetary, will give actual investment to the participating startups. That assigns some kind of a risk and a degree of seriousness for those who pay the bill. So if there is an investing company that sponsors the program, a sponsoring company, government, typically the requirements to run this program are much, much higher. The process, it's more demanding, but also the mentors are not necessarily so volunteering. I'm not saying they don't want to do good, but because this is also a job, usually those mentors are, let's say, more professionals and they come at a higher cost. Maybe they don't, but in this particular case, we accounted a triple cost for the same quantity of mentors because we want them committed. They want to have very good decisions when they make the interim cut, because after the interim cut, there'll be some kind of an investment to the prevailing ones. So the one who pays the bill for the program to run and the invest in the companies want to have very good selections. And that's why the money that the mentors are paid are much higher. So the first phase, because of this, you can see it has a greater value, the pre-acceleration process. And that relates not necessarily to more hours per team, but a higher cost per team. And that history repeats itself in the second phase, where the acceleration process takes place. And because it includes, on top of the program costs, the investment, okay, and the investment, let's say, is 20,000 euros for 5 teams. That adds up to 140,000 euros in total. The total amount that is allocated is 165,000 compared to 9,600 for a non-investing program. So we have two programs again. One, they both start with 20 teams. The first end up with 10 graduating and pitching. And the investing one starts again with 21, but ends up with 10 pitching, but 5 getting invested. So we have another step in the Darwinian process. Out of 20, 5 get invested. And they split an amount of 140,000. So the allocation value per team is higher, but the allocation of value, including the investment, for the invested team, for the invested teams, is even higher. By this, you can see the relation between an investment and an investing accelerator and a non-investing accelerator. And That allocation includes both the angle of, as I said, of resources and a degree of fairness for those who deserve to receive the investment. Okay. So this is a way to show you how the allocation breakdown takes place between two examples. Again, the numbers are indicative. You can run a program with less money, with less costs. We can run a non-investing acceleration program even with higher costs than an investing accelerator, depending on what the goal, what the promise is about. Now, not all programs run really well. Not all acceleration programs run really well, regardless if they have, you know, great names behind and nice, beautiful logos. There are specific reasons that they don't work very well. Reason number one, the goal, the setup of the program is not positioned. Let's say if it is a vertical, in a clear vertical, or an ecosystem that is well developed. So the positioning of the program and positioning, I have to give you the marketing term, is how the customers, in our case, the startups, perceive the program. Not how we perceive the program for ourselves, but how the others perceive the program. So it has to do with the perceived value that we promise we will give. And that promise is not fulfilled until the program is complete. Until then, it's only a promise. So positioning well the right service for the right players, the right ecosystem, is very important. We need to match what we want to do with the right ecosystem. When we do that, we reach the right team, the right teams. Maybe, let's say, we want to run a program about space, okay, and business in space, but the ecosystem cannot support it. We're not going to find the right teams. They're not going to find maybe any teams to do that. So that's why it's important to have a very good analysis of the startup landscape in our region. Another very common reason that the program might not run very well has to do with the absence of dedicated mentors and advisors. And the key word here is not mentors nor advisors, it's dedicated. Many programs that we see have common mentors. So you can see the same mentor in 10 different programs. One could say, where does this guy have time to participate and support 10 different programs? Okay, it does not compute. So there are many mentors, advisors that have the will to help, but they don't have the time commitment to follow through. We call them cosmetic mentors or cosmetic advisors, that no one will dispute their intention, but there might be a problem with their time commitment to follow through with the promise of the particular program that they offer their bio and the nice picture showing in the website. So when we organize, when we put together programs, it's good to have committed mentors, committed advisors. So if your program design says that I'm going to have someone to hold your hand 24/7, you have to have that person holding the startup's hand 24/7. Okay. If you are promising certain advisors, those, you know, that are supplementing the mentors in a way, okay, offering expertise, then those advisors need to be available when they are asked. So how you do them? And has the startup the ability to contact the mentor anytime, any place? Do they have particular time slots, office hours? These are important things you have to consider ahead of time, not discover and improvise when the program is actually running. Another reason for a program failure is the not adequate reach to find the right match of investing entities. Many times the program organizers, and that is due sometimes from lack of expertise or too much of an ambition, believe that the graduating startups out of their program will be the fantastic match for the investing entities of the local ecosystem. Sometimes they're not. Actually, most of the times they're not. Many times the graduating startups, although they graduated, are still way, they're far from becoming investment ready. So this is a problem. And it is also a problem when the promise of the program saying we're gonna have you pitch before investing entities cannot be fulfilled because the organizers themselves do not know enough investing entities or don't have the, even better, the right relationship with investing entities to have them being engaged with the program, provide either advice or being the demo day, and not as cosmetic because, you know, someone invited them, they have to be there, but because they actually want to do the job, and their job in a demo day is to provide first the right feedback, not just some kind of grading, fill some spreadsheets and that's it, but actually provide useful, constructive feedback, and not only the demo day. Sometimes certain starters might want to ask certain questions that will help them develop their investment readiness mentality, and fund managers or other representative of funding entities or even business angels can help them towards that. So it's a good thing to culture that reach if you're an organizer of a startup accelerator, because in that way you can help your startup get the right match with that entity. Absence, of course, of a clear goal setting, followed with the right strategy to achieve that goal for your program is vital. I explained that at the beginning, and maybe three or four times, and maybe you got bored or sick and tired of hearing me repeating the same thing over and over again. But absence of the goal, the right goal, a clear cut goal for your program is a deal breaker. Don't run a program unless you know exactly what you want to achieve. The absence of alignment among the program stakeholders. Who are the program stakeholders? The mentors, the advisors, a company sponsor, government, if it is, or any public institution that is involved, different levels of decision makers within the institution that are involved, and there is difference between how to execute a program and why we're doing it, and sometimes need for other reasons like publicity and stuff. Okay, publicity is good, but it's not the reason for doing something. If the reason is to help the ecosystem, you do the right thing to help the ecosystem. You have to align all those different stakeholders involved in the creation, support, and organizing, executing the program under the same thing. So you have to keep reminding why we're doing this, why we're helping the startups, why we're sitting at this time, at this day, at night, and talk and listen and get educated, why we sweat along with the startups to find the right recipe for their success. So that's the end of the presentation here for tonight. I also have an exercise for you guys. It is a take home. It's part of the requirements, but it's very easy. Basically, what I want you to do is map your local ecosystem with the help of one of the tools. And this is the tool I gave you. Let me share again. You'll see it's very easy. It's not gonna take you much time. You just need to go and understand how many programs are out there, what they offer. You can read the websites. And then when you do that, just mark with the next here. So you have the acceleration program title, or if you have a competition, you can have up to five. You can have two or three, depending how many you want to evaluate. But I believe three is a good number to be able to see the differences. And just mark with X's here what you see based on what is announced and what is known. So this way you can have a depiction, an easy depiction of your local ecosystem. It's not gonna take you a long time to do it. Just a little, you know, appetite to explore what's already there. Maybe you already know it because you have an idea what is there, what is offered in your ecosystem, if there is a competition, if there is an acceleration program, a bootcamp organized by university, and compare those. It's a very, very friendly, easy exercise. Just put the names and assign with an X if it is something like true, it is existing, the program, and that's it. I will upload this exercise, and that you don't have to do the rest of the spreadsheet. Don't worry, just this. I'm going to upload the exercise with instructions for you to do it, and you can easily fill the Excel with the right X's. I would like to know if there is any question so far on what we discussed today. Any questions, anyone? I don't think we have any questions. Is there anyone who is considering in participating in an acceleration program or organizing one anytime?
Maybe sometime in the future, not now.
Okay. All right. I'm not going to keep you any longer. I think we covered the material that we needed to cover for today. Just check the LMS tomorrow for any changes. I will upload the material there so you can download it and submit it. Okay, if you don't have any questions. All right, so thank you very much for attending tonight's seminar. I hope it was useful. You're very welcome. And I'll see you tomorrow, same time, 5:00 Moldova time, and we'll continue with budgeting an acceleration program. Have a great night. Hope you rest and you rest your brain out of this 3-hour extravaganza about accelerators. Take care, you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Good night. Goodbye.
Good night.